other questions which I can take offline maybe.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you, Animesh. So the next seminar will be by Walter Quattroschocchi, and he will again talk about social media, and in particular echo chambers in social media. So, Walter, can you share this? Okay, very good.
Can you see it?
Yes. Yes, so it's all yours. Go ahead.
Fantastic. So I will give a brief sketch, first of all, on the, about the approach we use to do in my lab. I mean, I'm at the University of Venice and leading the Laboratory of Data Science and Complexity. And basically what we love to do is a data-driven modeling of complex system. With the complex system, you are just, I think, more in this kind of stuff more than me, for sure. However, is a way to model processes in a way that everything is grounded upon interactions. And this can be used to afford transportation problem, biological models, economics, social science phenomena, and so on. Furthermore, in the last 5-6 years, we get this data deluge. No? We are overwhelmed by data. We have tons of data. And all this data, if implemented in the complexity paradigm, can be exploited to analyze and to understand social, economics, biological, epidemiological processes, as we saw even for the epidemics this year. The idea is not new. I mean, it's just already in 2009, there was a science paper by David Lazar that said that proposed to join forces between complexity, social science, and computational computer science, in order to bring up this new idea of the computational social science. So pass from a system in which we move mainly by speculation or on a smaller experiment, passing on a more hard version of the social science investigation. Furthermore, this issue is particularly solid even on the light of the problems in the reproducibility of experiments coming from psychology and sociology. I mean, there is this study in 2015 that was telling that almost half of the studies from sociology and psychology lack in experimental reproducibility. So it's really difficult to have a tough result and advance science with this kind of uncertainty in the kind of results we get. And so, after the proposal of David Lazar of the computational social science, several researchers and investigators start to work on this idea of exploiting data from social media, one of the issues on social media, to understand something about the social dynamics. But, I mean, as you can see on the top left corner, we have the distribution of languages by looking on Twitter on the state of New Jersey. So we can, there is a new way of building ethnographic map. You can see the geolocation of people, you know where they are, and so you can recognize the language, and so you can map the distribution of the place according to the language of the tweets. Or in the bottom right corner here, we have the distribution of language, the distribution of the Occupy movement according to Facebook. So according to the location for the people where they are meeting and so on, according to their post, we built up the map of the distribution of the Occupy movement on a global scale. However, my point here is that this is still not science. I mean, here we are in the realm of pure observational statistics. We are just describing a process. I mean, this is just a picture. We don't know anything about the process. We don't know anything about the dynamics. Today is like this, tomorrow it can be changed. So it is just a glimpse of something. It's a nice picture, but this is still not science. So in order to advance this issue, we framed this approach in which we started to grab information from various fields to set up a nice research question. And we started by the idea from the science communication of the agenda setting. The agenda setting is a theory that basically states that the more a news is covered by the media, the more it is perceived to be important by the users. So frequently and prominent discussion about the same topic get the effect to be perceived like more prominent and important to the audience. And basically this phenomenon is slightly changed in the last 20, 30 years with the rise of social media, where we passed from a system in which information were selected by experts, selected by journalists, and so they selected the information that have to be reported on the audience, to a more hybrid system in which we have a kind of disintermediation, where the likes and comments actually drive the actual agenda setting. People on social media decide what is important and what is not. And Mark Z just said that, really innocently said that we don't want to build a new community. We want just to allow people to share and get information easier. And actually, this utility component is the killer of the actual mainstream information system, because when everyone select the information, everyone produce the information, the problem is on the quality of the information. And so we decided to advance this scientific research question by proposing a kind of methodological approach that consists of finding research, framing in a good way the research question by studying the theories from other fields, and then apply the classical, we basically saw how we can answer to some of these questions by looking at the data we already have, and the answer has to be sound and tight. So we pass from a part of data collection and transformation, we perform the quantitative analysis, and then there is the modeling and validation part, so the classical scientific method. And the focus was on the spreading of information online, especially looking to social contagion, the collective framing of narratives, content consumption, and especially on opinion dynamics, but on a data-driven perspective. So the question for us was, is confirmation bias, so the tendency to acquire information that adhere to our system of belief, dominant in the diffusion of information? And we set up an experiment by looking at Facebook pages in Italy and in the US. Basically, we picked two different samples of clusters of information providers. One is the conspiracy thinking, the one related to chemtrails, blah, blah, so all conspiracy stuff. And as a control, we used the scientific information sources. So pages that are devoted to disseminate scientific results. We divided these two datasets and we collected in Italy around 2 million of users, in the US around 55 million of users. And the idea was to understand how exposure to a specific narrative, so conspiracy or scientific narrative, affect the way we consume information and we use our confirmation bias. The first finding that was not surprising, but really surprising, it was that people that follow scientific information source just follow only information scientific information sources, while people that follow conspiracy information just follow conspiracy information. So we get stuck in the kind of narrative we have, we love. Furthermore, we are surrounded by people doing the same. So if I'm a guy really active in consuming scientific information, there is a high probability that in my social network, my virtual friends are guys and girls really active in consuming scientific information. So we create kind of homophilic clusters in the way we share and select information. And the experiment was really simple. How guys usually exposed to conspiracy information react to intentional joke made to mock their narrative. So if you believe in aliens, how do you answer to an information that says that aliens forbid to use soap or to eat soap? So creating this kind of fictional mocking of the conspiracy narrative to see how those false information percolate within the conspiracy cluster. And actually the result is that the most of the interaction is come from people from the conspiracy side, both in liking and commenting. The second result, the second experiment, second part of the experiment was to measure how users generally exposed to conspiracy information respond to corrections. So if you believe in something that we know that is false, how do you react to a post telling that you are not right? That you are believing a fake story. So debunking, actually. And actually the result was quite depressing in a sense that the conspiracy guys generally ignore dissenting information, coherently with the hypothesis of confirmation bias dominating the process. And actually the small fraction of conspiracy guy that interacted with this correction post after the exposure to the correction became more active in consuming conspiracy information. It is called the backfire effect. If you tell to someone that he is not right, actually his reaction is gonna be to be more, to diving more deep in his kind of information sources, looking for his comfort zone. Now, actually, let's summarize what this experiment tells us. The experiment says that we are surrounded by information, so we can select actually the information we like the most because the offer is really high. We pick the information we like the most. We find people that share with us the same tendency, the same attitude, and we create this kind of homogeneous clusters. And the information circulates within this homogeneous cluster if the information adheres to the shared narrative of the group. So this can be exploited to create models, exact models of information propagation online. In fact, indeed, the majority of cascades pass from nodes having the same polarity, so nodes having a similar attitude, both for science and conspiracy. Despite the cascades dynamics may result different, the process of capturing the information directly from a friend is a friend that is sharing the same attitude is pretty similar. And there is the last final element. How, there is this hypothesis that is called the group polarization hypothesis that states that when two users, extreme users, are in the same group and surrounded with users with a different attitude, these two friends sharing the same narrative will tend to be more extreme in professing their shared narrative. So like-mindedness create kind of coalition in diffusing the information. And we measure how this phenomenon reflects on the sentiment expressed in the comment of the users. So the more you comment, how does it change the emotion that you are going to express in your commenting behavior? And what we found is that the more you comment, the more negative are the comments, both in both the echo chambers. And it is even worse when discussion come between users of two different coalitions. So if conspiracy guys meet scientific guys and start to discuss, the process became really, really harsh in a really small fraction of time. Now, of course, the objections we received to the study on the conspiracy and science story was that polarization is a normal component imposed by the selection we performed. I mean, we select two different words science and conspiracy, it is normal that people do not compel to these so distant narratives. So we keep the challenge going to see if these polarization dynamics dominate even the consumption of information, and we performed this analysis on 376 million of Facebook users. And we analyzed how news get consumed on Facebook. And what we found is that actually a dynamics that is supportive for the confirmation bias hypothesis. So the more you are active, the less the number of news outlets a user follow. So we concentrate our activity on specific page. Those is called selective exposure. And so we find a strong polarization that is consistent in several situations. We find polarization, looking at this, the same polarization that we find in science and conspiracy. We find it in the Brexit side, we find in the vaccination debate. And so we decided to explore the hypothesis of the interplay between polarization and misinformation dynamics. So the more there is polarization, the more it's going to be the probability that you are going to meet some fake news. I don't like really the term of fake news because everything can be fake under a certain level of uncertainty. But let's use this because it's actually the mainstream definition. Basically, the idea is that the fake news diffuse when there is a polarizing topic. So we set up a kind of framework, let's say a combination of algorithm for the analysis, which by starting from the news sources and applying natural language processing, topic extraction, and performing combining sentiment analysis, and accounting for some feature from the user's behavior, we can perform a classification in which we can filter potential misinformation targets according to the misinformation dynamics. And as a final point, as a final remark, we think that this polarization, so this kind of clustering in echo chambers, is a combined effect of the social attitude of the users and the algorithm of the platform. So we decided to perform a comparative analysis on Twitter, Reddit, Facebook, and Gab to see if the tendency to be surrounded by users having an homophilic attitude is dominant. And actually we find that Gab and Facebook and Reddit provide this issue. However, if you look at the picture on the right, if we go to look on the polarization dynamics on Facebook and Reddit on the news consumption, we find that actually on Facebook polarization is really dominating the process, while on Reddit it is not. And the only difference between the two is that on Facebook you have social feedback algorithm, while on Reddit we don't have it. And wait 1 second. This is the group that performed this experimentation and is still performing this experimentation. It's really multidisciplinary. It's composed by computer scientists, people from economics, physicists, mathematicians, engineers. And this is my actual group working here. About the impact of our research, we get, for instance, the result on the debunking that doesn't work and change the mind of conspiracy guys, make it close the debunking column of the Washington Post in 2015. So there was a column, what was fake on the internet this week, that ran the article, why this is the final column, and was citing the plot I showed you before backfire effect. We got a lot of media coverage, we get translated in all languages, we have one article on Scientific American. Actually, I wrote an update of this article that is gonna be out on next September, so how the information about the echo chambers changed over this issue. And the result I presented here to you, was used to inform the Global Risk Report of 2016 and 2017. And actually we are working together with the Minister of Innovation, the Italian Authority for Communication, and for Facebook, even during the COVID time. What we did, we used the mobility data from Facebook. Mobility data, so on your mobile phone, if people, users with their mobile phone running Facebook and with the GPS open are tracked by Facebook according to their position. What we found is that according to the mobility restriction implemented by several places from the various countries, we focused especially on Italy, and we found that actually the municipality that are more affected by the reduction of the mobility structure and according to the efficiency of the connectivity network are the most poor municipality in the countries. So we get that the impact of the lockdown and the mobility restriction is asymmetric according to the economic predisposition of the country. And this opens another question: how a nation is resilient to kind of mobility restriction? So we model the lockdown, the mobility restriction, like a natural disaster. So there is a moment in which you are basically stopping your activity. And we measure, according to this mobility data, how France, Italy, and UK responded in the implementation of the mobility restriction. And what we found actually is that basically the main effect, the really simple effect of the lockdown is a shortening of the small world behavior. So we tend to isolate clusters. So the reaction to the pandemics is to close. However, this reaction is implemented differently in all the three countries, depending on the previous infrastructure of mobility they have before. And actually it reflects the historical background of the nation. And we map and measure the resilience of this structure to a percolation approach. And, Italians are not so proud of their country, usually. I mean, we generally feel really sad. We are Italians, we are not good at all, we are not good. However, we found that we have a really strong, resilient network. And this makes me happy because, I mean, at least my confirmation bias sometimes is not confirmed at all in a positive way. And that's all my stuff.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this very nice presentation. So I had a general question just to start. Did you also see whether this phenomenon, this polarization phenomenon, is getting better or worse across time? I mean, do you see trends in
increasing? Actually, it's increasing. Uh-huh. It's really difficult to monitor a trend because the number of people changed, the use changed, the topics changed. However, it seems that the trend is going to increase. This polarization trend is increasing.
I see. Uh-huh. Thank you.
Chansung here. Very interesting talk. You just mentioned the evolution of or development of polarization. I want to have a question about this possible understanding of the dynamic of polarization. How, say, when you have your experiment, how when the signal is propagating, it's just because you have underlying like a group of people, they form like a dense community, or during the process, you have some kind of reinforced like a dynamical process, for example, by recommendation, right? You have this kind of infection and spreading in a kind of explosive way due to recommendation.
I don't think that social dynamics, information spreading, can be modeled like a virus, just for a simple thought. When you select an information, you have the intention to share something. So you can select what you want and what you not, while with the virus you cannot select. And so this process is dominated mainly by the homogeneity of the cluster. So you are mainly exposed to similar information. So you are not exposed to information that are different from your perspective, but because you don't want this to happen. And this dominates the propagation process, at least from what we saw from this data. I mean, I'm not saying that this is universal. From this data on Facebook and with Facebook, Twitter and YouTube and Gab, we can see this, actually.
Yeah, so the people try to spread, they already know the targets where to spread.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, thank you.
So there is a question from Lei Han. Maybe Lei Han, you can ask this question yourself.
Okay. Yeah, just from this slide, there seems to be significant difference between the northern and southern Italy.
Yeah.
What are the ramifications in terms of the things you discussed in this talk?
I mean, because the economical, as I told you in the previous paper, the last Pinayes paper we get is on the Italy. And basically, we found that the main mobility restriction affect the poorest municipalities. And actually, the southern part of Italy is the one with the really finding difficulties in the development and economical development, even, and this is given even from the infrastructural connection. So railway station, railway trains and so on are really not well connected. So we live since a lot of time, this really differentiation in areas that reflects actually really our historical background.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so both economic and cultural.
I think more economical than cultural, I think. More economical than cultural.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think we extended a little bit into the coffee break or break. And so if there are no other questions, then I think we can stop here. And thank all the speakers for their very nice. Oh, wait, there is a, looks like there is a question. Do the echo chambers network show small world characteristics?
Yes and no. Yes. Those are really dense and connected community with a short diameter. But
yeah, because, more like a globally coupled. Okay.
Bye. Why with the short diameter? But the overall Facebook is with a short diameter. So all the social media suffer this small world effect. So I don't think that it already happens, but it's by definition is the shrinking diameter of the interaction.
Okay, thank you. So okay, so we reconvene at 10:30 Central European time, and what time will it be?
4:30 p.m.
Okay.
4:30. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, thank you very much again, and see you in a while.